All right, I would like to talk about this little card game called, I guess it's called Oriente. And I'm going to butcher a lot of these words, but like Luca Coppola, I guess maybe, and by Mayfair Game and Da Vinci Games. And this is 2004, 4 to 12 players. And I will tell you, you probably want at least 6 players for this game. At least. You go up to 12, but 4 or 5, I don't think it's worth playing. Age 10 or higher, 20, 30 minutes to play. And it's about right, about 20, 30 minutes once you learn how to play the game. And so let's take a look at what's inside this. So when we open it up, we get an instruction sheet. And it looks pretty massive, but it's not as difficult as it looks. Because some of it's just explaining the special ability of cards and also different languages. So don't let that intimidate you. You also get some cards, and there's different types. I'm gonna put that over there. So you have this kind of like reference card that you can leave out, and it explains how many of each card are in there. So ninja, there's 3, nofu, 12, akindo, 7, samurai, 6, and so forth. This is their card value. So the higher the number, the stronger the card is. So a 0 is the weakest card, where 7 is the strongest. And these are basically the special abilities these certain cards can do. You also have what would be called, I want to call it like the marketplace or the market square or something like that. So there's that card. You have the geisha card. This is basically end of game. When this is drawn, the game's over. You will have some treasure cards. Not all these are treasures. I mean, there we go. So then you'll have these treasure cards, 2, 3, 4 value. And then these are the cards that were referenced here. So like ninja, nofu, akindo, daimyo, etc. So the maho tsukai is a 5, and so forth. So that's what these cards are. So you also get these tokens. And there's basically 3 different types. There's the workers or laborers, which is this token. Everybody gets an action disc. So you spin this to be able to do your action, and this is whose turn it is, this marker here. So let me get all this cleared out, and we will see how to play this game. So one of the things you want to do is take your what's called the workshop square and put it in the middle, and next to it, put all the laborers. So it's these little yellow tokens here, little wood pawns. So I'm going to put those there. You can also put this out there as a reference that somebody needs to look at and go, well, what does that mean if you learn the symbols? Each person gets an action disc. So we're going to say there's 4 players. So these 4 players are going to get an action disc. Now, again, you would want to play with more people. It's more fun with more people. Then you're going to take the treasures and shuffle those up. And each player is going to get one face up to start the game with. So this player gets that. And a lot of times what they say is turn them sideways so you don't get confused with a card that's in your hand. There we go. The rest of these cards are not used in the game. So these are the only treasure cards used in the game. Then what you need to do is pull out of this deck the 3 ninjas and the shogun. Those go separate, so I'm going to put those there for now. The rest of these cards get shuffled up. I'm just going to do this real quick. And you're going to make 3 stacks. The first stack has 1, 2, 3, 4 cards. Second stack, 1, 2, 3, 4. Third stack has the rest of the cards. And what you're going to do is you're going to take the geisha and put her in this. It could be the first pile. One of these 4 has 4 cards in it. And you're going to shuffle it up so you don't know where she's at in this pile and put it on top of those 4 cards. So there's at least 4 cards up where the geisha's at, but she could be here. Second card, third card, and so forth down, but there's at least 4 below. Then you're going to take the shogun and the ninjas and shuffle them into this big stack. This way, the ninjas and shogun don't end up at the bottom. They're at least going to be used in the game. Because remember, when the geisha's drawn, the game is over. So I'm just going to quickly shuffle these. Let's just pretend they go on top. This is the starting stack. Do not shuffle this again. Each player then gets one of these cards, and it's secret what each player is, but the person's going to know who they are. So this person, say this is me, I'm going to look at my card and go, okay, I am a soryu. Soryo. Okay, so I'm this with a value of 6. That's pretty good. I'm pretty high up there with this special ability. And I'll get to what all this means, but I have no idea what these other people are. Then you take the top card, and I'm actually going to take this out of the way for just a little bit. Move this over so we have room here. And this gets turned sideways. Now we're ready to start the game. So basically, you can decide who goes first. So we're going to say this person is the first player. And they can decide to fulfill their destiny or not. Now there's two ways you can fulfill your destiny. Is you attack another player's card, one of these identities, with your card, or you do the special ability that your card allows you to do. That's it. So if you want to fulfill your destiny and say you want to attack somebody, you have to flip yourself over. If you want to say, hey, I want to fulfill my destiny, you have to flip your card over. Now everybody knows who you are. It's no longer a secret. And there's a reason why sometimes you want to keep secret. And this person, so you kind of pass that along there and say, this person, they can decide, I don't want you to fulfill your destiny. I want to be able to. Now, when I decide I'm going to attack, I have to decide who I'm attacking. And if I attack this person cannot fulfill their destiny, interrupt me, because they're the target of the attack, so it goes to this next person. As long as they have an action chip, they can try to interrupt my turn. Now, how do you interrupt me? Basically, your card value has to be higher than mine, so really only the shogun. So let me get these values back out here. So 6 is really hard, high up there, and there's only 2 of those cards, and this is one of them. So there's one more out there or in this pile or there, and there's one shogun card out there, but we don't know where that's at either. If they tie, say this person has a soryu, and they tie me, whoever has the least treasure cards. So they both have one treasure card, so even if they had a 6, they cannot interrupt me. So the only one could be the shogun that could interrupt me. So let's see who this person is. Well, they're 1, so they can't interrupt. Now, of course, they won't show that face up. They just go, you know what, I'm going to pass. And actually, since I said this is my target, it would go past him anyway. This person is a ninja. They got a 0, so they can't interrupt. And so they'll go, no, I'm going to pass. This person, so you kind of bluff a little bit because you don't want people to know who you are. So that's a nofu also. There's a lot of nofu in this game. And this one person may say, no, I'm going to pass. So it goes back to them. They can now fulfill their destiny, and they're going to attack. And how you attack is this person has to now flip over their cards. You're going to spend your action disc. You only get 1 per turn. So once this person's done, they cannot take any more actions till everybody's taken their action or passed, and the next turn goes, and they get their action chip back. So this person flips over. They're a 1. Well, 6 is going to be the 1. But what they can do is they can call for help from other players. So they can go, can anybody help me beat this? Now, if this is a lower number, it'd be a little easier. These other players can say, yeah, I'll help you if you give me your treasure card. Or something like that. You know, you negotiate what you want to trade and stuff like that to do this. Because if this person, say this person wants to help them, I don't know why, but say this person wants to help them, they have to use their action chip. This person does not. So if you assist, you have to use your action chip. So they battle each other. This one, nobody's helping. So this one won, beat this one. This card is now added to this person's treasure value. They now have 4 points of treasures. This person now gets a new identity. This person did their action, their chip is in. Now, they were the first person this turn to fulfill their destiny, either attack or doing their special ability. So they get to also add this card. Oh, look at that. That's 6 treasures right there. That's 10 points this player has right now compared to 2, 3, and 2. This person's basically done. It now goes to this person. Do they want to fulfill their destiny? Do they want to attack somebody or do what's on their card? And it goes like that until everybody passes or everybody's put their action chip in. Now, I'm going to try to set it up. Okay, we'll set it up this way. So here we go. Just pretend. Okay, so this person says, I want to fulfill my destiny and do my special ability. They're not wanting to attack. Oops, I need to get a different card here. There we go. We'll do that. Okay, so this person's got a 2. So it goes here, and they want to do their special ability, which does not affect them. But we'll just say it takes the top card off here. Okay, this person, if they have a higher than a 2 on their card, well, they're the ninja. They won't. They can interrupt them. Or if they're 2 and have less treasures, they can interrupt. Nope. This person goes, no, I want to fulfill my destiny. They flip over. This person does not get to do their action. This person now has a higher card than they do, so they get the privilege of fulfilling their destiny. So now it goes around one more time. Can't do anything because action chips in. This one cannot interrupt the 3. This one decides not to. Goes back here. This one can now do its ability. And its ability is attack, and if it says it was going to attack this one couldn't interrupt anyway. Just kind of backtracking there a little bit. So that's it. And then this person attacks this one, and the others don't want to help, but he has a special ability. Boom. He uses that, so he got a total of 7, and I'll get to their special ability. Gets to add this. This person is now that face up. Okay, so that's basically it. And you keep going around until everybody's done their actions. When we get to these special abilities, you understand more about what some of these cards actually do than just, oh, I beat you, my card's higher. There's a little more nuances than that in the game. Hold on until I get to the special abilities. Now, the game's going to end immediately when that geisha card is drawn somewhere at the bottom here. There it is. Once that card is drawn, boom, game is over. That's it. Done. Whoever has the most treasure, this person would be the winner, but there's ways they can lose that, and I'll get to special abilities. You can win the game that way, but there is a way that you can win the game even if you have the lowest amount of treasure, and I'm going to find those guys, and it has to do with the ninja. So let me find my little ninjas, and I know what this guy was a ninja. There's 3 ninjas. If at the end of the game, and you have to keep your treasures like this, you can't hide them. You have to keep them out like that where everybody can see them. If you have all 3 ninjas at the end of the game when the geisha comes up, you automatically win. Doesn't matter how many treasures everybody else has, you have those 3 ninjas, you automatically win. So that's the 2 ways you win, 3 ninjas or the most treasure. If you are tied for the most treasure, whoever has the highest value treasure wins the game. So if somebody else has whatever value this is, take the ninjas out. There, they only had 2, so they didn't automatically win. This person has a 6, the other person has a 4, this person would win. Now, I want to go over special abilities because this is the meat and potatoes of the game. So let me just clear all this off. So I'm going to start with the shogun first because when I get to Nofu, it's going to make more sense knowing more about what these are and stuff. So the shogun's special ability is this, that if he's ever the target of an attack, say this player says, I'm going to attack you. If he's ever the target of attack, he automatically wins. That's his special ability. However, if he attacks somebody, he can be defeated. It's only when he's defending. Now, if we had one player here, and this player had a 5, and this player goes, hey, can you help me? We got an 8, we could beat that 5, I'll give you 2 of my treasure cards. And he goes, yeah. And then somebody else comes in, and they join, this, say the samurai joins this guy. Now they have an 8, beat him. He can be defeated when joining up. It's only if he's attacked will his special ability kick in. So that's his ability, is he's basically invincible as long as he is the target of the attack. Now, the Soryo is pretty interesting. As you see, this is like 2 pile of cards here. What that's saying is you have this one here and that treasure card next to it that the first player that fulfills their destiny gets. That's basically what he's saying. I want to fulfill my destiny and take that card. Being a 6, it's hard to beat them. So he goes, oh, I want to do it. Nobody can beat me. I'm going to take that and add this to my treasure. That's his special ability. Okay, Maho Tsukai, kind of like magician or wizard or something like that. And what you do is, this is kind of a nasty deal. Let's say this person's a samurai, this person's a nofu, and then the other person is shogun. Shogun, okay? And then we have these cards in the middle. What this person goes is say, I'm gonna do my special ability. Everybody's cards are turned into him. This goes onto the bottom. This player secretly chooses one of these. Maybe he goes, you know, I want to be the shogun. Then he draws one, shuffles him up, and then just, now, each of these players, if they're all face up, they know, well, this player took one of them. There's two others, but there's one new one out here. And so now who is who? So they don't know who this person took. They don't know what the other players have, but they know there's, they know three of the cards, but they don't know that mystery card. Now, let's see what everybody turned into. Interesting. Okay, so let me go put this Maho Tsukai back out here. And I'm going to try to find another Maho. There we go. Okay, so let's say these people are face down. This one's face up. This player's here. If there is already a Maho Tsukai up, because maybe this person did a battle, this person cannot flip over and do the special ability. So that's something to keep in mind. If there's already one out here, you cannot also do it. If it was face down, that's a different story because you didn't know. And they're not going to go, oh, you can't do it. I'm, you know, if you go, I'm going to fulfill my destiny and you take these up, you choose one of them. This goes underneath and go, oh, I'm going to take that one. This, shuffle, they get passed around. You can do that. It's just that there's another one up. So keep that in mind with the Maho Tsukai. All right, we're getting to the one that has two abilities. You can't do both. You got to choose this one or that one. Okay, this first one. So this is the daimyo. And this person is shogun, let's say. And then we got treasure cards here. This first one says, I get this top card. Even if that one was taken first turn, they get the top card. Now, what's interesting is if it goes around and they're the first player to fulfill their destiny, they get both of them because they were the first player to fulfill their destiny and his destiny is to take the top card. So then they'd add that, he would add that to their treasure pile. That's why they also turn those sideways so you don't get, people don't get confused as who's who. Now, the second ability says four to seven, you're swapping. So you can swap your daimyo for the shogun. Now you're the shogun, they're the daimyo. Now you hope they've already spent their destiny token so you can keep this. If not, they can go, I want to fulfill my destiny. You can't stop it. Boom, it goes back. Another thing that could happen is, let's say this is this person's treasure pile and that's who they are. This is the nofu there. And you go, I want to fulfill my destiny. I want to take the shogun. You take it from their treasure pile and you become shogun and that goes to their treasure pile. So you basically trade that card for wherever this card is at. If you know it's, if you see it, if it's face down, of course you don't, you can't do the trading. So that's what the daimyo does. Pretty interesting little card there. Two abilities. Now, samurai, it'd be kind of what you expect is battle. So let's say he goes, hey, I want to battle that Tsukai. Well, he's a three and that's a five and nobody wants to help. You'd think he would lose. But no, with his special ability, when he goes in battle, he gets an extra card. He draws this top card and adds it to his value. One. So he would have lost. If he, whoever loses, so let's say, I'm going to draw one. There we go. Okay, so this is what he drew. Seven. He beat this person. This one he defeated goes into his treasure pile. Whatever he drew, that's what that person becomes. Now, let me put it back to kind of that situation, and he drew this, and this person was that five. Well, he lost. So what happens is this goes to their treasure pile, and he turns into a nofu. So the samurai can be good, can be bad, but his ability is just attack people. But he gets a bonus when he attacks. Okay, number two, Akindo. Not a very high card, but let's say this player here, this is their treasure. What his special ability is, and he has two of them, is he can first take go to anybody's treasure pile and take all their nofu. So if this person had three nofu, they are now three nofu in his treasure pile. So the other special ability is it has to do with treasure cards also. So let's say this is the situation. He's like, huh, I got nofu. You know, those are that's 3 points. This person got eight. So what he does is this person, he chooses this person as the target. These get shuffled up. This player randomly takes one and gives one to them. So now this person has four, and this person, ooh, good draw. This person has seven. So he can steal people's cards. So that's his two abilities, either take all the nofu from a person or randomly take one and give one card back to the opponent. Now, the only stipulation is if it's a face-up, another face-up Akindo, you cannot target that person with your abilities. If they're face down, you can, because they haven't revealed, you can do it. So you know what? I'm gonna take all your nofu. Boom. Now you're down to true treasure, and I'm up to this. Number one has two abilities. And it all has to do with that place and the laborers. These are like the peasants, the workers, and stuff like that is what this card basically represents. What it is you can take one of these and add it to that. Then, let's say another player is a nofu. Let me see if I can find one real quick. This player can add one, and what happens is this one gets knocked down there, and this one's in there. The only one that's going to count for the second ability is the ones that are not in the circle and not out here. So they have to be down here. So it comes back around, another turn, they put another nofu down there. And it comes around, and they're adding up these nofu. And let's say that's it. Now they can do their second ability, and that's revolution. I will say, though, if you're only playing 4 to 7 players, so 8 to 12, that's what you do if you're adding. If you're playing 4 to 7, instead of them going here and then being pushed down, they're automatically just added there. But we're going to say we're playing with 8 or 9 players, and so this is what we're looking at. So I kind of wanted to set this up saying you didn't know what was going on here. Let's say this is a situation. You're the nofu. You got to fulfill your destiny. You put your action chip in. Instead of adding a dude, you're going to call for revolution. So then you go around a table, and each person can join a revolution. The only way they can join is if they still have an action chip. So we're going to say this is the only player with an action chip, and they have to spend their action chip and join the revolution. They would have to flip over. So you go to this player. No, I won't join. This player, yeah, you know what? I'll join the revolution. They spend their action chip. No, no. What happens is you add up how many are in here. So since we're playing this many people, we're going to throw those down there. So we have 5, 6, 7. Everybody has to flip over their card. So now we know who everybody is. That's why you don't want to do this unless you've got a lot of nofu in there or laborers. So anybody that's 7 or less on their value of their card here in front of them is defeated by the nofu. So what happens is everybody lost. So the nofu put their cards together like this. These players randomly have to give them half of their cards rounded down, so each of them is going to give one card. If somebody, let's say this person had 4, they're going to have to give 2 randomly. So 2 random cards get thrown in here. And then these get distributed equally. Well, I shouldn't say equally. Between the two players, starting with this one. So you go 1, 1, 2, 2, 3, 3, 4, 4. And if there was another one in there, this one would get the extra one. And then they flip it over, and that's their new treasure pile that they have. So it's a way to gain some treasure from the other players. If they have a lot of treasure, you're going to get half of them, but you have to build that up. So that is the Nofu. Let me clear this off. The last card is the Ninja. And basically, their special ability is they point to one of the player's cards and says, it's dead. They go, dead. Nothing they could do about it. That goes there. And then that pile of cards. Oh, let me get the geisha out of there. They then become this. If that was the geisha, it would have been over. So they now become that. But can they kill the shogun? Because remember, if he's attacked, he automatically wins. Nope, this is fulfilling your destiny with your special ability. Just like the daimyo can trade, this one go boom, I'm killing him, I'm assassinating him, you are now that, and this is now in my treasure pile. So that's what the ninja does. And so once you get enough people that all these different cards are out there messing with people's treasure piles and Nofu's getting thrown out there and you want to defeat the Nofu so you don't lose your treasure cards, it's a really, really fun game. But you need at least six players. But it's a really, really good game, and you should try it.